Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam Namaskritya. Naram Chaiva Narottamam. Devim Sarasvatim Vyasam. Tato Jaya Mudirae. Nashta Prayeshu Abhadreshu. Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya. Bhagavati Uttama Shloke. Bhaktir Bhavati Naishtiki. Krishnaya Vasudevaya. Devaki Nandanaya cha. Nanda Gopa Kumaraya. Govindaya Namo Namaha. Hare Krishna. Reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11, Chapter 9, entitled Detachment from All That Is Material, Text 19. Kevalatmanubhavena Swamayam Trigunatmikam Sangshobhayan Srijatyado Taya Sutram Arindama Kevalatmanubhavena Swamayam Trigunatmikam Sangshobhayan Srijatyado Taya Sutram Arindama Kevalatmanubhavena Swamayam Trigunatmikam Sangshobhayan Srijatyado Taya Sutram Arindama Kevalatmanubhavena Swamayam Trigunatmika Sangshobhayan Srijatyado Taya Sutra Marindyama. Mataji? Kevalatmanubhavena Swamayam Trigunatmikam Sangshobhayan Chidratyado Taya Sutram Arindama Kevalatmanubhavena Swamayam Sangshobhayan Srijatyado Taya Sutram Arindama Kevalatmanubhavena Swamayam Trigunatmikam Sangshobhayan Srijatyado Taya Sutram Arindama Kevala Pure Atma of his own self, Anubhavena, by the potency, Svamayam, his own energy, three Guna, modes, Atmikam, composed of Sangshobhayan, agitating, Srijati, he manifests, Adau, at the time of creation, Taya, with that energy, Sutram, the Mahat Tattva, distinguished by the power of action. Arindama, O subduer of the enemies. Translation and purport by the disciples of His Divine Grace, Srila S.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. O subduer of the enemies, at the time of creation, the personality of Godhead expands His own transcendental potency in the form of time and agitating His material energy, Maya, composed of the three modes of material nature, He creates the Mahat Tattva. Purport. The word Kevala means pure and indicates that the Lord's Kala Shakti or time potency is a transcendental energy non-different from His personal body. The Brahmana addresses King Yadu here as Arindama, subduer of the enemies. This indicates that although the topic of Maya or illusory creation is being discussed, the king need not worry because as a staunch devotee of the Lord, he is able to subdue the real enemies of life, namely lust, anger, and greed, which make one a prisoner in Maya's kingdom. The word sutram indicates the Mahat Tattva on which many material creations rest, just like jewels rest on a thread. In the state of pradhan or material equilibrium, the modes of nature do not interact. In the third canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, Lord Kapila explains in his Sankhya teachings that the Supreme Personality of Godhead agitates the neutral state of nature and thus creation takes place. The created manifest form of nature in which fruitive activities are stimulated is called Mahat Tattva as indicated in this verse. If one tries to renounce the illusory creation of the Lord by taking shelter of impersonal Vedanta philosophy, thus artificially equating the infinite consciousness of the Lord and the infinite simul consciousness of the conditioned soul, one's analysis will fall far short of reality. The word Svamayam in this verse indicates that the illusory potency that covers the conditioned souls is always subordinate to the Lord, whose consciousness is infallible and infinite, and who is always a person. Om Ajnana Timirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Svapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurum Vaishnavamsha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunatham Vitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakham Vitamsha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Shri Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpataru Vyascha Kripa Sindhu Vyayevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhaktivedanta Swami Niti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine Jaya Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shrivasadi Gaura Bhaktavinda
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
O subduer of the enemies, at the time of creation, the personality of Godhead expands his own transcendental potency in the form of time and agitating his material energy, Maya, composed of the three modes of material nature, he creates the Mahatattva. Hare Krishna. So first I would like to seek the blessings of all the assembled Vaishnavas, His Grace Pankajangri Prabhu, all my worshipable senior God brothers and all the devotees who are here. Many of you may have assembled here thinking that Gaur Gopal Prabhu is going to take the lecture. And it's like a cruel joke. But yeah, it was somehow it happened like that. So I seek blessings of everybody to speak on this very exalted topic about the creation of the Lord. And I'll try to speak not so much about the process of creation, but what has been created. You know, if you see over here, what is being spoken about in this particular verse, the Lord expands His potency in the form of time and agitates His material energy. It's mentioned, it's not agitating the material, agitating His material energy, Maya, which is composed of the three modes of material nature, and then creates Mahatattva, and then from that all the remaining creation happens. So this actually reminds me of we used to, in my college days, so I say that I used to be a chemical engineer. I'm not one now, but I studied chemical engineering. But in chemical engineering, we used to learn all kinds of chemical reactions. Anyone who understands chemistry here? Quite a few people. So we used to study chemical engineering reactions. So reactions means what? Two chemical substances are brought together. They react. They react and they produce some new chemical. Something new comes out of it. Now, there are quite a few chemicals which if you just bring them together, immediately they react. Like you take the element of sodium, you don't add water to it, you add it in water because it's a hugely, explosive reaction. So you just take a little bit of sodium and add it in water, immediately, it starts reacting and heat is generated. Exothermic. So there are some reactions, however, which if you take those two chemicals and add them together, nothing happens. So in such reactions, when you take the chemicals together and you add them together, nothing happens. Then the chemist, the person who is making the reaction, he tries different things. He adds heat. He heats the mixture. He heats them together. And then little bit something starts happening. Then he applies pressure on it, increases the pressure. Atmospheric pressure is what we all live in. If the pressure is increased, like in a pressure cooker, then the thing starts cooking. So when the heat, right amount of heat and right amount of temperature, right amount of pressure is added to these chemicals, then they start reacting and something is produced. So that is what we call a endothermic reaction, exothermic and endothermic. So this is science but of course we are discussing science only here today, so therefore I am trying to stay true to the topic. So If you see the in a factory, if you go to a huge factory, you know, of course we are very fortunate, we live very close to a factory. You know, we live in Chembur, which is still has the last few remaining factories in Mumbai, the refineries and RCF. So in RCF we have this plant which produces something called ammonia. So ammonia, you know, the familiar smell that you get in the monsoons in Chembur is basically ammonia. So ammonia is what? It is basically nitrogen, which is the most, you know, commonly available element in the air, and hydrogen coming together to produce ammonia. But how does this happen? In the factory, it is not that, you know, people take one cylinder of nitrogen, one cylinder of hydrogen and just throw it together and chalo, ban jata hai. No, there is a watchful eye. Under the watchful eye of a chemical engineer, these chemicals are brought together in the right proportion. Right amount of nitrogen, right amount of hydrogen are brought together, and then under tremendous heat and tremendous pressure, the amount of pressure that is applied is 200 times the atmospheric pressure, right? So that's the kind of intense environment that's created, from which ammonia is created. So this is what we call the Haber's process. Now, what we should understand from this is that even though these chemicals, the chemicals nitrogen and hydrogen, if they are brought together, they can create ammonia. At least on paper, they can create ammonia. You know, when we write a exam, we write nitrogen plus hydrogen creates NH3 ammonia. But in reality, there is some process that's needed to make them work together. In much the same way, as described in the Srimad Bhagavatam, 3rd canto, 26th chapter, as referred to in the purport, all the raw materials for creation, they exist in the unmanifested form as what is called here as pradhana. So this pradhana is these 24 elements which exist, which are mentioned in the Gita, which are mentioned in various places in the Srimad Bhagavatam. So these 24 elements, they exist as, you know, they are just lying there and in the unmanifested form. Only when the Lord, who is like that chemical engineer, you know, who applies his glance, he glances upon this pradhana and mixes it with the element of time, which is the 25th element. There are 24 elements, and the 25th element is the element of time. So when time is mixed with these 24 elements, which are lying in a neutral state called pradhana, then the process of creation starts. So the Lord then impregnates the material nature with his glance, and all the living entities enter into the material nature. So Srila Prabhupada mentions in that purport that by itself, material nature, it appears. If you see, if the scientists look at material nature, what do they see? That material nature is acting, reacting in very wonderful ways, right? We see so many things. That plants, you know, react, they react with the sunlight and water, and they produce leaves, they produce fruits and flowers. Animals interact with each other, they eat each other, you know, and so the whole ecosystem that we see going around. And the scientists observe this, and they think that, oh, this is so wonderful. You know, material nature is so wonderful. They are not willing to accept that there is a creator. A creator who has created all of this, these wonderful things that we are seeing, this material nature has not come about by accident. As clearly mentioned in the Bhagavatam, it is happening by the will of the Lord. Otherwise, things will just be, it is like a pause button is pressed. You know, you press a pause button, nothing moves. Screen, on the video screen, you're watching something, and you press the pause button, everything stops. And then, person presses the play button again. Again, things start playing. So who is the person who's got the remote in his hand? It is the Supreme Lord. You know, the Supreme Lord has got the remote. Without his deciding to press the play button, nothing plays. You know, so that is what is explained over here. And he says, Prabhupada says, by itself, material nature appears to the scientists to act and react in a wonderful manner. But in reality, it cannot act without the agitator, which is time. who is the representation of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Sometimes we see in offices also people are like that. They are also like Pradhan state. They are all staying, they just sit there in the office, they wait for someone to come and tell them. And you know, like in those who are working in IT industry especially will understand that there are sometimes people, many people sitting on bench. They don't have any work. They are told ki kuch karo, kuch time pass karo, kuch develop karo, do something, you know. So they are just sitting there waiting, nothing happens. And then suddenly one day there is a project. And then the project manager comes with a whip, you know. And then everyone starts, chalo, everyone start running. And then everyone is given some task. And all the people who are just sitting there in a very, very mild way, with had no pressure, no anxiety in life. You know, only anxiety was, pata nahi, I may lose my job. But otherwise, they are just sitting very peacefully, no whole day, they are on their phones, they are doing time pass. But then suddenly, all of a sudden, the project manager comes and infuses the energy, gives them the purpose that, okay, now this is what has to be created, we have to create this. So, shuru ho jao. And then suddenly, everything is galvanized into action. Everyone starts moving. So these principles that are being spoken about in the Srimad Bhagavatam, we should not think that this is something, you know, just some theory, some ridiculous stuff, it doesn't make sense. No, absolutely, we see this even in day-to-day life. We are able to see these principles even in day-to-day life. Things remain dormant, someone comes and creates. There is cement and sand all over, you know, limestone all over the world, in the form of what? Mountains and earth. And then someone comes, takes these elements and builds a great building. Right? So, we see that this principle is applicable everywhere. It is visible to us everywhere. So, the point that is being made here is that the world, how it is created, the material world as we see it, how it is being created, is amazing. It is amazing and it is unbelievable at the same time. For us to understand, to accept also, intellectually it is very difficult to accept that one person, however powerful he may be, the Supreme Lord, he just glances and everything starts. Swabhaviki, the Lord doesn't need to make any special effort. It's not that he sat and he thought that, okay, how shall I do it? And you know, okay, maybe I'll try this. Maybe. He just thinks and it gets done. Through the agency of Brahma, through the agency of material nature, everything starts manifesting, tuck, 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 by the influence of time. So what the Lord has created is amazing and at the same time extremely unbelievable. But the process of creation is unbelievable and amazing. But finally, what is created also is unbelievable and amazing. We have to understand that what the Lord has created in this material world, we don't have the eyes to really observe. Somehow, if you really look around and if you start observing, you will see, like in this particular section of the Srimad Bhagavatam, this Avadhut Brahmana, what is he doing? He is speaking about what lessons he has learnt from 24 different either persons or things in this material world. So he learns from the bee, he learns from a snake, he learns from a python, he learns from a young girl in the previous verses, a young girl who has come she is a beautiful young girl who is eligible for marriage. And when her parents are out, some 2-3 suitors, men who want to marry her, they turn up there. So she wants to serve them. So he learns from this, he learns from everything. So for a person who has that vision, or at least has that, I would say, the desire to learn, we can learn from anyone. We don't need to learn only from, I will only learn from college. After college, sab kitab band, I will stop learning now. I've learned, you know, bahut seekh liya, bahut ho gaya. I will only learn from Vyasasan, jo niche aata hai, that's all. I will not hear anything else. I don't want to learn anything else. No, learning is available from anywhere. We can learn it from anywhere. And that is what this entire, you know, this entire section of Srimad Bhagavatam is giving us a feeling, that if you want to remember Krishna and you want to see the hand of Krishna in your life, your particular life, you can see it in everything. You don't need to go searching very far. You don't need to come only to the temple. Of course, we should come to the temple. We should take association of devotees, because here that experience is very stark. You can very clearly see the hand of God. You can very clearly see there are like 1,000 devotees sitting here. We can see how all of them somehow subtly or very, very directly have been influenced by Shri Radha Gopinath. That's why we are sitting here. That's why we are, you know, sitting in this temple hall. But even outside, there are so many things that can show us the hand of God if we start looking for it. There's a beautiful thing, you know, that while this material creation is amazing, it is unbelievable, but still to understand it, we need a little bit of faith. Because if we go with the scientist's view, then everything we start measuring and we start looking at. But if you look at with faith, it's so easy actually to accept the material world. There's less energy utilized if we accept the material world and the spiritual world with faith. What is around us, if we accept it with faith, not blind faith. Nobody asked, Srila Prabhupada used to always say that don't have blind faith. Question, understand, and after that accept. But if we have faith, once we have done the, you know, the manjan, pura discussion kar liya, samaj liya sab kuch, after we understand everything, then if we place our faith and we accept that the Supreme Lord who's created this wonderful material world can do anything, then life becomes very easy. Like there is this story that Srila Prabhupada tells about this very great scholarly Brahmana, and there was also one cobbler. So both of them were devotees of Lord Narayan, Lord Vishnu. And what happened was that Sri Narad Muni was passing through, and he met with both this Brahmana as well as this cobbler. And Narad Muni, when they met Narad Muni, so both of them paid obeisances to Narad Muni and said that, oh, you know, you are the most fortunate, you are able to see the Lord Pratyaksha in this body, you are able to see him face to face. So can you, when you next time when you meet Lord Narayan, can you please ask him one question? He says, yeah, please tell me. He says, please ask that, you know, when will I go back to Godhead? When will I go back to Vaikuntha? So Narad Muni says, certainly I will ask. So Prabhupada says, so Narad Muni then went to Vaikuntha, and when he met Lord Vishnu, he asked him that, my Lord, when will, you know, I met these two devotees of yours, so when will they go back to Godhead? So Lord Vishnu, looking at Narad Muni very casually, says that, cobbler, you can tell him this lifetime itself he will go back to Godhead. And what about that scholarly Brahmana? He will take several lifetimes. I don't know when. Bahut time lagega usko. He'll take a lot of time. So Narad Muni is surprised. He says, "Arey, the Brahmana will take more time. The one who is so scholarly, who knows, who's a knower of scriptures, he will take so much time. And the cobbler will come back in this lifetime." He says, "Yes, that's what I'm telling you." So then, when seeing the confusion on Narad Muni's face, Lord Vishnu tells him that, okay, when you tell them this, they will ask you a question that, acha, what, just tell me, what was the Lord doing when you met him? So that time you tell that he was threading an elephant through the eye of a needle. So Narad Muni says, okay, and he goes down. And when he comes and meets with this cobbler and the Brahmana, first he meets with the Brahmana. And he tells the Brahmana, so Brahmana says, oh, Narad Muni, you have come, thank you, you know. And he says that, please tell me, did you meet the Lord? He said, yes, I was fortunate enough to meet the Lord. So what did the Lord tell you about me? When will I go back to Godhead? He says, oh, you will take, the Lord said, you will take many lifetimes. Many lifetimes? Me?
I am doing so purely all my sadhana, I am doing everything so nicely. How can you say that I will take so many lifetimes? I am sure you never met the Lord. It's not possible. So Narada says, no, I met the Lord. And this is what he said. Says, hey, if you met the Lord, tell me what was he doing. Says, he was threading an elephant through the eye of a needle. The moment the Brahmana hears this, there, that's it. Now it is very clear that you have not met the Lord. How is it possible? How can he thread an elephant, through the eye of a needle? How is it possible? What ridiculous thing you are talking. No, this is not possible. Go away. I don't believe that you met Lord Narayan. So Narad Muni goes away. And then subsequently he comes and meets with the cobbler. And when he meets with the cobbler asks him, he glorifies Narad Muni and says, my Lord, were you fortunate enough to meet the Lord? He says, yes, I was fortunate enough to meet Lord Vishnu. And he told me that you will go back to Godhead in this lifetime itself. This lifetime itself, you will go back to Godhead. So the cobbler is ecstatic. His eyes are filled with tears. With so much gratitude. He thanks Narad Muni and he asks that, my Lord, what was my Supreme Lord doing when you met him? So Narad Muni says, he was threading an elephant through the eye of a needle. So that cobbler, he's just so ecstatic. He says, my Lord is so wonderful, he can do anything. So Narad Muni says, wait a minute. I said he was threading an elephant through the eye of a needle. Did you hear me correctly? He said, yes, I heard you. You believe me? He says, yeah, what is so difficult to accept in that? So how you believe this? He says, what is so difficult for the Lord to do? He says that I am sitting here under this banyan tree. This massive banyan tree which is spread over so many feet, you know, if one seed of that banyan tree, from one seed of that banyan tree, inside that seed, there is another banyan tree. And there are millions of such seeds, and each of those seeds contains the blueprint, contains the entire design, the entire everything that is needed to create a new banyan tree is contained inside that one small seed. Look at the brilliant engineering of the Lord. Who can replicate this kind of engineering? It's unbelievable that just a small seed, a mango seed, when you plant a mango seed, mango tree only comes out. Right? The scientists say everything happens by chance. Then when I plant, I should be able to plant orange seed and get mango tree. Why when I plant an orange seed, I get an orange tree only? When I plant a mango seed, I get a mango tree only. So this is the perfect creation of the Lord. So this cobbler says, what is impossible for the Lord? What is difficult for him? One who can do this, how difficult is it for him to, you know, thread an elephant through the eye of a needle? He can do anything. So, this is the wonderful creation of the Lord. With some faith, we can understand. You know, there is this beautiful video I had seen a couple of years back. Somebody had sent it. It's only a 3 minutes video and it's there on YouTube. You can look it up. Unfortunately, I didn't have a projector. I would have shown it to you. It's only a 3 minutes video. So, many of you would have already seen it. But when we see it, we don't understand sometimes what is the, when the first time I saw it also, I just saw it as a video and I was like, wow, what a well-made video. But in the context of this, when we look at it, we see that what is the creation of the Lord. So that video starts with a woman who is lying down on the floor and the camera pans on her eyes, you know, they show her eyes. And then from her eyes, it goes away. The camera unzooms from her. And it goes further and further away. First it shows, you know, the state of California. Then it shows United States of America. Goes a little further away. Shows the entire two continents. Goes a little further away. It shows the Earth planet. It goes a little further away. It shows the Earth planet and the moon. A little further away, the Earth planet as part of the entire solar system. Then from the solar system, it goes further away. Solar system amongst many other such star and planet systems, and then finally it goes several, you know, millions and billions of miles, light years away, and it comes into the Milky Way galaxy, which is a
Massive thing. They speak about the size of the Milky Way. It is massive. Already have come some millions of light years away from where we started. And you're seeing the Milky Way galaxy. And then there are other galaxies called Andromeda, Ursa, and so on and so forth. So these are names which scientists have given based on what they speculatively think that, this looks like a new galaxy, this looks like a new galaxy. Because really what they can see is only stars in all directions. And something they see which gives them an indication, maybe there's another galaxy here. Really there isn't any clear scientific knowledge about it. It's all in their, calculations that, this looks like another galaxy. So finally it goes to some billions of light years away and it stops there and says, this is the all the galaxies and this is the cluster of the universe, which just looks like one big web. You can't even make out what is there in it. So this is the universe. So imagine all these planets and all these stars and all these galaxies are floating in air. They're just floating. They're not just floating. See, if you take 10 balloons which have got helium in them and you release those balloons, what do? They also float. They go up, But after they go up, is there any control? How they go? They go in any direction. Depending on which way the wind is blowing, which one is slightly heavier, which one is slightly lighter, it just goes in any direction. The scientists may try to put an equation to it. This is the equation by which it flew up. It will go in this direction now. But it is very difficult to predict. It goes in any direction. So all the planets, all the stars, all the galaxies, entire universes are just floating in air. Floating in space. And they are not just floating randomly. They are floating in a very particular manner. So this is what that video shows first. And then again it starts zooming in, from the universe to the galaxy, galaxy to the solar system to Earth and Moon to Earth, Earth to Americas, Americas to United States, United States to where that girl is lying down. And again pans into her eye. And then from the eye, it starts zooming into the body. So of course, this is just a fictionary video. It can't be really done, but it just shows in just 3 minutes, it shows what this fantastic creation is all about. In 3 minutes, you get a feel. So it goes inside and shows the eyes, the different parts of the eyes, the retina, the cornea, the iris, the pupil, There are four or five working parts in the eye. We're all looking at each other right now. But there is tremendous science that is at work, and it goes inside. Then from the eye, it shows the blood vessels, the capillaries. From the blood vessels, it goes into the blood cells, red blood cells, white blood cells. From the white blood cells, it goes into the chromosomes. So chromosomes are every human being has got inside his body 50 trillion cells. How many? 50 trillion cells are inside our body at any point of time. Maybe little less, maybe little more, but 50 trillion cells are there. And each of those cells is made up of 46 chromosomes. So these 46 chromosomes, it goes to those chromosomes. Those chromosomes are made of something called DNA. So then that DNA is made up of fibers which are wound together like this. It's called a helix. Scientists have discovered DNA. They've discovered by going deeper and deeper into the human body, they've discovered something called DNA. That DNA is like a helix of fibers. Each fiber is of a size of 10 nanometers. So to give you a feel of what is 1 nanometer. So 1 meter is this much, right? 1 millimeter is this much. So something that is 1/6 the size of this 1 millimeter, you can't even see this 1 millimeter. 1/6 divided by 6 times, not 6, sorry, not 6, no, sorry. 10 raised to 6 times actually. 10 raised to 6 times of that millimeter, not even 6,000, 1 millionth, sorry, it is 1 millionth the size of 1 millimeter is the size of 1 DNA fiber. And that DNA fiber can be further broken down into, amino acids. amino acids are made up of compounds which are made up of atoms. Atom is broken down further into nucleus, proton, neutron, electron. Nucleus further is broken down, that protons and further broken down something called quarks, and the dimension they have mentioned there, something called femtometers. I don't even know what is a femtometer, right? But it is something like 10^-15. At that level also something is going on, and because something is going on at that level and it is going on correctly, therefore that atom behaves properly. Because the atom behaves properly, the DNA behaves properly. Because DNA of a person behaves properly, one person speaks like his father, another person speaks like his mother, one person looks like his grandfather, grandmother, one person looks like her grandmother, another person looks like somebody else. Somebody is tall, somebody is short, somebody is fair, somebody is dark. All this is happening because at the femtometer level something is happening. Can you believe? This is the engineering we are working on. So the scientists, what can they do? They can only discover. They can discover these things. They can go to the DNA level and they can discover, they can observe. If they have the instruments, they can measure. Really today there aren't any instruments which can measure the DNA. This is all just anuman. They are putting some sort of calculation and saying that, okay, this is what is probably a nanometer and this is what the size of the DNA is. For it to have all this, it must be this size. So it's described that if you take all the DNA that lies within our, okay, I'll come to that later anyway. So the scientists can only discover, observe, measure, and at best manipulate all these elements. They can manipulate little bit. The part of the human, who manipulates the human body? Doctors, right? So doctors, not manipulate, they do it with a good cause to heal us, but they are playing with some of these elements. They are playing at a much more gross level. They are not playing at the level of DNA. Science has still not reached there. They're trying, but they have still not reached there. Manipulation is still at the body, gross level, which is the cells, the glands, and so on and so forth. So they can only manipulate all these elements to a very small extent. Very small. There is, what control do you have on how the earth rotates? What control do we have on how the wind is blowing? When there is a storm, hurricane that comes, what do people do? Can they say, okay, let us, we have these nuclear missiles. Let's shoot these nuclear missiles at the storm. And when it goes into that storm, it will rotate and it will blow up. And because of that, the storm will be dissipated. Hari bol. Doesn't work. You may try anything, but material nature has decided to destroy. Everything will be destroyed. It will come back with more force. If you try to go against material nature, that is what we are observing now, isn't it? That people have tried to defy material nature for decades and decades, for almost 100 years now. You try to defy material nature, she comes back sood samet, with interest. So they can try to manipulate, but they can't control anything. And more importantly, what Srila Prabhupada says in his books, they cannot produce anything. They cannot produce anything. Either at the macro huge level, they cannot produce planets. They can produce satellites, small mini satellites which rotate around the earth, which imitate what the moon does. But they can't make a moon. Nobody can make a moon. Nobody can make an island also. You take land from somewhere else and put it, but you can't just create. You need land, still, to create that island. You can't create, Prabhupada said, when there was this in the Life Comes From Life book. In that book, Srila Prabhupada is speaking with his disciples. He says, ask these scientists, can they produce one drop of milk? The cow is just eating grass and producing milk unlimitedly. Can they produce one drop of milk? Can they? Can you create a grain of rice? We're eating rice every day. We'll eat hopefully now also. Right? But can you create one grain of rice? Any scientist? Farmer is doing it. But farmer also needs rice to produce rice. He can't just produce it. Can the greatest scientist in the world produce one grain of rice? No. So scientists can at best take rice, from that rice they will make some different, you know, varieties, but they can't make anything. So we should understand, what is this world? This world therefore cannot be just, you know, cannot be scientifically understood fully. You cannot. It's too unlimited. Goes all the way, as I said, into the universe, and goes all the way into very deep into the human body. For us to understand this body and this universe in this lifetime is not possible. However, with faith, if we accept the words of the acharyas, if we accept the words of Srimad Bhagavatam, life becomes very simple. We can see the six sigma, you know, those of you who are from, anyone from manufacturing background understands? Six sigma, okay, so one person only, so I'll not talk about it. But, you know, the perfection with which this material world has been built, there is so much perfection in it. We have to just look around and we will see how much perfection has been built in this world, the perfect world created by the Supreme Lord. So, now more and more scientists all over the world are being forced to accept. They're being forced because of science only, not because of any scripture or some great preacher has gone and converted their hearts. No. Because of scientific discoveries, they are now realizing there must be a creator. So, some of the most profound and most well-known atheists in the world are being forced to accept that there must be a creator. There is all signs of intelligent design in this world. So without boring you with too much of details about what is the, you know, but we should just understand, just for brief, I'll just touch upon it. If you look at the force of gravity, we all know what is gravity. We pick up, who discovered gravity? Newton discovered. He discovered it. He didn't create it. It's not that before then there was no gravity. There was. He just discovered. He realized, oh, why is this falling down? So gravity is the force that forces things to fall down. When you hold it, it falls down. Gravity is the force that holds planets together. The sun's force holds its solar system together. Gravity is the force that keeps the moon within a particular range of the earth. Gravity is the force that keeps all the universes, you know, together. So, what the scientists have discovered by scientific experiments is, if this force of gravity increases by a very, very, very minuscule amount, very minuscule, not, and minuscule means I am saying there is no name for how minuscule. It is not like it reduces by 10%, 1%, 0.5%, 0.1%, so 0.0 followed by 60 zeros and then 1. So you can imagine, it's like it's practically 0. So 0 followed by 60 zeros and then 1, that much percentage, if the gravitational force increases, what will happen? All the universes will collapse into each other and there will be nothing. There will be no planets, no stars, no life. By how much? 0 followed by 60 zeros and 1. That much percentage, if the gravitational force changes, increases, this is what happened. And if it decreases by that same amount, decreases just by that much, by that 0.0001%, what happens? All the planets and universes will start drifting away from each other. So if the sun, for example, which is about 93 million miles away from the earth, if this gravitational force decreases slightly, immediately the earth will move away from the sun. All life on earth will freeze. Everyone will die immediately. Not immediately, maybe within a day, half a day, everyone will die. If it increases slightly, we will be sucked into the sun. We will all die instantly. If it increases slightly, the moon will come and crash into the earth. Moon, which is today just happily rotating around us. It is actually moving away slightly. The scientists claim that the moon is moving away slightly. But, you know, if it slightly increases the gravitational force, it will come and crash into us and killing God knows how many. Right? So this is the order at the universe level. How much order is there? So the scientists have observed this and they have said that this shows that there is intelligent design. This is not something that has come about by chance. They have accepted now that this cannot be by chance. This has to be intelligent design. Similarly, there is another great engineer in this observable universe. You know, universe is something very great. We find it difficult to even conceive in our mind. But there is one engineer that is there. I mean, there are thousands of engineers in this room. So you may say, bhai, I am not engineer, I am doctor. I am chartered accountant, I am this, I am that. No, but all of you are engineers. How? Because in the womb of our mothers, what have we done? We have all been engineers. Not by our own volition, we have not done. But the baby in the womb of the mother, so this is again science. Science has proved this. That the baby, what does the baby start from? One cell. Just one cell. One, you cannot even see that cell. It comes from the egg of the mother and the sperm of the father. One cell is created. And that one cell starts then dividing. And as it divides, you know, it divides, it becomes slightly bigger in size. As it divides, it knows at what speed it has to divide, incidentally. Although indiscriminately nahi, ki human being ka jo bachcha hai, Shirada Gopinath Bhagwan ki jai. The child of a human being, its engineering function knows that in 9 months only I have to grow. Not that in 4 months bahar a gaya. No, it knows I have to grow at this speed. So it expands at that speed only. And it expands, the cells keep expanding. At one point of time, some cells decide that, okay, I'll become a hair cell. I'll become a cell of a hair. I'll become a bone. Another one decides, I'll become the liver. Another one decides, I'll become the heart. Another one decides, I'll become the eyes. This complex eye that we have is coming from that cell only. That first cell, that one cell has all the chemistry and all the ingredients and all the instructions that at what time you have to become what cell and at what speed you have to grow. Unbelievable. So the scientist, one of the persons, a Christian preacher who was, you know, preaching to somebody, he says that the baby at one point of time, when it grows, at one point of time, the baby is producing 15,000 cells per minute. Each minute, 15,000 cells are being produced by the baby. Bahar se koi kar raha hai? Is mother overlooking? Hey, aaj 15,000 nahi hua, aaj 12 hi hua. No, it is just happening on its own. Swabhaviki, naturally, it's just happening. 15,000 cells per minute. And he says, each of those cells is like producing a space shuttle. What is the most complicated, you know, engineering in this world? A space shuttle. Because it has to break through the atmospheric pressure and go out. So the engineering that goes into making a space shuttle is very complex. Right? We say that this is not rocket science. When we tell somebody casually, oh, this is simple, it's not rocket science. Because rockets are complex. So what one cell is, that one cell is so complicated because scientists have gone to the cellular level. They've been able to see through their electron microscopes. They've been able to see the cell. That cell is so complex. There are so many things going on inside one cell which you can't even see with the naked eye. That one cell is as complex as making a rocket. So this baby is producing 15,000 rockets per minute. This is the engineering that is going on inside your body when you're just a baby. What control do you have? Nothing. Who is doing all this? Who has built all this complex engineering which works on its own? It's not as if only very educated mothers baby mein yeh sab hota hai. No, even someone who is illiterate, their child also will produce the same cells. It is unbelievable, isn't it? It's amazing. This is what is there in the human body. So we don't need to look very far, actually. If you just look at how when you're speaking, now if I ask you quickly, just answer quickly, okay? Whoever answers quickly is the best. Who's the Prime Minister of India? How many seconds does this take? He answered first. How many seconds? Less than a second. Maybe about 0.3 seconds, something like that. Cut say he answered. But, you know, Radha Gopinath Prabhu gives this example that what is the process that happened between my asking this question and his speaking this answer, right? He spoke first. So what happens is, I decided to ask a question. You know, in my mind, I decided to ask a question. The instruction went to my brain. Brain told my tongue to vibrate in a particular way. Tongue vibrated in a particular way. The vocal cords vibrated in a particular way. And the sound came out that who is the Prime Minister of India? And through the sound waves, it reached Prabhu. And it reached all of you. Okay. Now, after it entered his ears, what happens inside the ears? Inside the ears is a complex mechanism. It goes inside the ears. There is, you know, initially a receptacle which receives the sound. Then it pushes the sound to the eardrum. The eardrum then vibrates. That vibrates behind the eardrum. There is a certain type of fluid. I think it's called synovial fluid. That fluid then vibrates and it goes and there are some hair-like particles. Those hair-like particles vibrate in a particular way, creating an electrical impulse, which then goes to the auditory nerve. That auditory nerve conveyed it to his brain. It interpreted the sound. Question is being asked, who is Prime Minister of India? And then the brain went and retrieved from somewhere. Prime Minister of India, Narendra Modi. Kadak. It retrieved the answer. And very quickly, he was eager to give the answer first. So because he was eager, very quickly it went back, gave the instruction to the tongue, vibrate in a particular manner, and the answer came Narendra Modi, and that vibrated back, came into my ears, and I saw him speaking first. All this in how many seconds? 0.3 seconds. So this is what Gopinath has done. We should not see Gopinath is standing with a flute. It is unbelievable what he has created. And it's just like that, swabhaviki, he's not had to struggle. He didn't wonder for millions of years how I will create something that is self-sustaining. This is self-sustaining. It is not that somebody beech-beech mein aake koi, you know, somebody is pumping in some knowledge into the system. This is happening automatically. So this is the process of hearing. Then another thing, of course, I spoke about the DNA already. It said that the DNA was one of the main reasons why scientists started accepting that there must be some intelligence in creation. Because, you know, looking at the planets and everything, one can still say, oh, it's by chance. But when they started looking at the DNA of the human being, then they realized that, no, this needs intelligent design. It's not possible. So even one of the so-called Mahajans of the world, of the current world, which is Bill Gates, he has also accepted that there must be intelligent design. Because the DNA, though it is so tiny, we said what? Nanometer, right? That DNA is so tiny, if you take all the DNA in the human body, you take all the DNA in the human body, it works out to how much? 1.5 teaspoons. Because it's so minute, right? If you take out, you suck out all the DNA from the human body, it comes to about 1.5 teaspoons. But because it is so minute, it is in fiber, it is in that helix thing. If you take out that fiber and stretch it out, it can go back from here to the moon and back some 50 times. One human being, huh? That is how much DNA is there in your body. This is all science. This is not scripture. This is science is saying this, right? And the amount of information contained in that DNA. Now, you may wonder, ki where does the information come that one cell becomes this, another cell becomes that? Kaun ye decision leta hai? Who decides this? It is the DNA which contains all the information that is sufficient for the cell to then produce. Right? So, the amount of information contained in one person's DNA, one person is said to be more than the total number of words spoken since the time human beings started speaking. Okay, time immemorial basically. That much information is stored in one person's DNA. So now before you ever call a person ignorant, you know, think. Because there's tremendous amount of information sitting in his body. It's just that he's not realized it. He's not been able to utilize it, right? But there's tremendous amount of information lying in just the DNA. So when the scientists realized it, they saw that there is literally software at work. That, for example, now if, let's take an example. Everyone knows acupressure? Acupressure means what happens? I have a headache, so I press this point, my thumb. So what is happening there? When I'm pressing, certain impulses are being passed through and it is going to the brain and it's giving me relief, right? So what is at work at the micro level? It is the DNA. The DNA gets an instruction that there is a need for certain nutrients or proteins to be sent from point A to point B. There is a need for a nutrient to be sent from point A to point B. So it picks up that protein, it puts a label on it. This is all science, huh? This is not speculation. It puts a label, just a courier label lagata hai. You know, if you buy something from Amazon.com, then there's a label they put on it, right? So it goes to the right address. So there is a label that DNA puts on that protein and it sends it to that location, precise location. It goes to that precise location. In that precise location, the label is removed and the protein is utilized. All this is happening right now while we are talking in our bodies. Isn't that wonderful? This is the creation of the Lord. Then, another thing. Every living being has been provided with food. Every living being has got food. Isn't that amazing? Again, we take these things so much for granted. See, all this creation has been done. So it's been done. Somebody has done it in the past. Okay, I am just enjoying it. You know, fine. But think about it. There is food for everybody. Srila Prabhupada mentions in Ishopanishad, Jivo Jivasya Jivanam, that living entities are food for other living entity. You know, but he says, but the point in human life is that we should recognize who is the provider of everything and we should surrender to him. But just see all the nutrients that anyone in this creation needs are already provided. You need proteins, they are there. You need carbohydrates, they are there. You need fats, they are there. You need fiber, they are there. Everything is there in food. You want to eat vegetarian food, it is there. You want to eat non-veg food, any food you want to eat, whatever you eat, decide to eat, food is available. The animals never go hungry. You see, animals, most animals don't die of hunger. They die because someone else kills them. The Supreme Lord is providing for everyone. We may think that, you know, I have created a nice jungle in which all these animals I have kept and, you know, I have kept space for these animals and therefore they are provided and therefore they are surviving. No, that is the biggest misconception. We are not the providers. We are not the doers. It is the Supreme Lord who is maintaining everything that we see in this creation. So food is there for everyone. And all of this, you know, it is mentioned in that verse, in that section of 3rd Canto, 26th chapter. All of this is sustained by whom? All these wonderful things, phenomena that we discussed at the cellular level, at the DNA level, at the bodily level, at the universal level, all of this is sustained by whom? By the Supreme Lord. That's why we say, you know, that creation is easy, but maintenance is very, very difficult. To maintain all this at the microscopic level and at the macroscopic level, same person is doing everything. You know, one of the expansions of the expansions of the expansions of the expansions of Supreme Lord Krishna in the form of Paramatma. So he mentions here that all of this is sustained by the Lord by adjusting all these 24 elements. These 24 elements along with time, in ingredients ke saath, sab kuch adjust ho raha hai. Everything is adjusted by these elements. That's it. Right? And how it is adjusted and how it is maintained? In the form of Paramatma from within. From within, it is a Paramatma who is maintaining, and from without as time. Of course, even from without the Lord is existing as Paramatma within everything, within every atom, within every living entity. As the Paramatma, He is there. He is maintaining everything. Everything is working like clockwork. Why? Because He is maintaining. Whatever human beings maintain, degrades. We are trying to maintain our city. What happened? Degraded. We are trying to maintain our country. What happened? Degraded. We are trying to maintain peace on earth. What happened? Degraded. Whatever human beings do, even with best of intention, best of efforts, we are not Paramatma. We are not Bhagwan. We cannot do. We have our limitations. Lord is unlimited. He can unlimitedly maintain unlimited things. No problem. So this is the Supreme Lord who has created this perfect creation. But then what does He do? When He comes to this earth, when He comes to this earth planet, what does He do? He sports as a small child. So Gopalji, as Gopal, as Shri Gopal, as beautiful Gopal, He comes as a small baby, as a very small child who's completely dependent on His mother's milk to survive. That same Lord who is maintainer of everything, from whom everything has come, Aham Sarvasya Prabhavo Matta Sarvam Pravartate, that Supreme Lord comes in the form of a baby. When He comes in the form of a baby, He is playing with His Gopa friends, with Balramji. And when He is playing, one day Balramji comes and complains to Mother Yashoda, "This Krishna, not today, He has eaten clay, He has eaten mud. He's becoming too naughty, you must do something." So Yashoda Mai becomes very, very concerned. She immediately calls Krishna and says, "You come here. That Balramji is saying you have eaten clay." Krishna says, no, that Balramji is angry with me today. Therefore He is telling all these lies. I have not eaten any clay. I have not done any of this. Already Yashoda Mai was quite thrust. You know, she was already very harassed by all the complaints that are coming from the gopis and gopas. So she's already harassed and now he's eaten clay also. He says that because Balramji is angry, therefore he is telling lies. Nothing. I have not eaten clay. So if you have not eaten clay, then open your mouth. So when he opened his mouth, he didn't say ha ha ha. When he opened his mouth, she was able to see the entire universal creation inside. She was able to see the rivers. She was able to see the mountains. She was able to see land. She was able to see the earth planet. What we described in the beginning, the earth, the moon, the solar system, all the different planets. She was able to see the external energy of the Lord creating all of this. She was able to see everything, all the universe, the creation process, everything inside His mouth. Small, this much small, 1 inch big mouth. She was able to see everything inside His mouth. And then when she sees again like that, you know, they have probably taken that idea of that video from this Leela only. From all that she's seeing, all the creation, suddenly she sees zoom. She sees herself looking into His mouth. And that becomes too much for her. She's completely bewildered when she sees this. And she says, at that point in her mind, she starts thinking that who is this child? Who am I? This child is the Supreme Lord and I have been thinking that He is my child. Who is this child? Who is my husband? And she's completely bewildered. She's thinking, this is the Supreme Lord. I must pay obeisances to Him. You know, I have been doing this and that. She's thinking like that. At that time, what does Krishna do? He just pulls the curtain down. The curtain of Yoga Maya falls over her and immediately she again forgets everything. And she thinks, this is my child. She forgets the part where He had eaten clay also. That also she forgets. Because of love for Him. She forgets that and she immediately thinks, He's my child, I must feed Him. And she takes Him on her lap. So this is the wonderful, unbelievable Leela of the Supreme Lord, who on one hand creates this magnificent, incredible material world. How? By glancing upon it. By glancing upon it, there is so much order at the universal level. There is so much order. at the bodily level, there's so much order at the cellular level. Just by the glance, the desire of the Lord, everything happens. Everything is perfectly created. And that same Lord comes and becomes helplessly dependent on the love of his devotees. That my devotees will now offer me bhoga. It is, bhoga is going on now, just now. Right? He is waiting when they will come. When this Prabhuji will stop, finish his lecture. You know? So he is also waiting. So this is the beautiful, that's why it's called Leela. That's why the Lord says, Janma karma cha me divyam. Evam yo vetti tattvataha tyaktva deham punan janma naiti. Mameti swarjuna. So one who studies the material world will understand material world is incredible. Hey, great, God is so great, God is so great. But then after that he sees the pastimes of the Lord. And he sees that the same Lord who created all this is doing such sweet, loving pastimes with his devotees. This cannot be reconciled. We cannot understand this. So what do we say? This is transcendental. This is not something of the material world. The pastimes that the Lord shows with his loving devotees cannot be compared to anything in this material world. The love that the Lord has for his devotees cannot be compared to anything in this material world. Therefore, janma karma cha me divyam. So the creation of the Lord is divyam. His activities are divyam. His appearance in this world is divyam. And his disappearance is also divyam. So we are going to discuss the disappearance of the Lord in this future sections of the Bhagavatam. So the appearance, disappearance, activity, desire, past, everything the Lord does is transcendental. If we can just understand this, our lives are perfect. So similarly, like Krishna covered Yashoda Mai with what? With Yogamaya potency. He covered her. In the same way, it is mentioned in that section of Srimad Bhagavatam, Maya covers the knowledge of the living entity. Because the living entity, Jivera Swarupoye Krishnera Nitya Das, what is the soul's eternal constitutional position? That we are the servant of the servant of the servant of the Supreme Lord. That is our constitutional position. We have a blissful, eternal, loving relationship with the Lord. But what happens? Covered. We have that knowledge. All that knowledge is stored in the heart, you know, in the soul. It's there. Sat Chit Ananda. So the Chit is the knowledge. The soul is full of knowledge, but it gets covered by Maya. So Maya covers the knowledge of the living entity with her illusory energy. What happens as a result of that? We lose sight of all these large and small details. All these details that we discussed, we lose sight. We forget everything. We just live in our day-to-day lives. We simply get engrossed in trying to enjoy the material world. We don't stop to think that who created, why he created, how he created, what is this wonderful chemistry at work, what is this wonderful engineering at work, how has he done it? How is it that we can only try to imitate, we can't replicate? I can't create a bone. I can put something artificial, but I can't create a bone which generates itself. I can't do that. We don't stop to think. We just get engrossed in the material world. You know, prakriti kriyamanani gune karmani sarvasha ahankar vimudatma kartaham iti manyate. I think I am the doer. I am the enjoyer. I have to enjoy whatever is available. Mereko jo by whatever means, by, you know, beg, borrow or steal, but I will enjoy. So we are so engrossed in this, we don't see God all around us. Krishna says in the 7th chapter of Gita and the 10th chapter of Gita, he tells us 100 different ways in which you can remember him. He says, I am the taste of water, rasoham apsu kaunteya. I am the fragrance of the earth. This fragrance of the earth is what produces a mango. Same earth, same water, same sunlight. But one plant produces a sweet mango. Another one produces a sour musumbi. Isn't it unbelievable? one produces a very fragrant rose, another one produces a yellow flower which has no fragrance but beautiful yellow. Same brown matti, colorless water and colorless sunlight, and it is producing all these wonderful creation. We don't see, but if we see, we can see Krishna's hand in everything. Really, if we change our viewpoint, our nazariya, as they say, if we change our nazariya of looking at the material world, we can see Krishna everywhere. So the pure devotee so as it is mentioned in the previous verses, the pure devotee, however, he sees all this. He's able to see, you know, Srila Prabhupada has given us all this knowledge. We've seen. He's seen the material world. He refers to Bhagavatam, fine. But he doesn't get stuck in all these details. We don't need to. In fact, none of us in this room here need to get too much, you know, intricately stuck into these details. Achha, I also want to know from today, how does DNA work? Sun liya, ho gaya, khatam. There is no more need for you to delve into the details. It's a waste of time, right? But what does the devotee do? As it is mentioned in the previous verses, the devotee, like the snake, the rat, with great effort, he goes and digs a hole. Bahut mehnat karta hai wo. He struggles very hard and he digs a hole and he goes and lives in that hole. What does the snake do? Snake comes, enters the hole, eats the rat and then lives in that hole. Very comfortably. He does not make. So this is mentioned in the previous verses. So this is the characteristic of the snake. So the Brahmana, Avadhut Brahmana, is learning from the snake also, that how what I can learn from the snake, that don't make too much endeavor. Material world will anyway provide you, material nature will anyway provide you what is your fair share according to your previous karma and your previous desires. It will anyway come to you. Don't struggle too hard. So the devotees don't struggle too hard. They do, but they don't struggle like this, like what material people are struggling. Instead, whatever material world is providing, whatever material nature is providing, they utilize it in the service of Shishi Radha Gopinath. So this is the nature of the pure devotees. And amidst all this organized chaos, see, we see if this material world, we look at it, it is chaotic, but still it is organized. So amidst all this chaos, all this organized chaos, what do these devotees do? They throw us a rope. You know, if you start looking at the material world, are, how the sun is there, how the earth is rotating around it, or maybe sun is rotating around the earth, you can get into all these details. But amidst all this chaos, so much killing, so much violence, so much hatred all around the world, amidst all this, someone comes and throws you a rope. A pure devotee throws us a rope. What is that rope? The rope of the holy names. Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare. The rope of the holy name, which can extricate us from this miserable material world, beautifully designed, but not meant for us. Don't make a plan to live. Arey, kitna achha bataya. Ye toh, matlab, beautiful place to stay. I must stay here longer. No. You should understand, this is meant to bewilder us. This bewilders us. So the devotee throws us the rope of the holy name. Devotee gives us the rope of Srimad Bhagavatam. He gives us deities so that we can be extricated from this miserable material world and go back to the dham of the Supreme Lord, Supreme Personality of Godhead. So all of us can take shelter of the instructions of Srimad Bhagavatam, take shelter of the deities, take shelter of the holy name, perfect our lives and go back to Godhead in this very lifetime. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Any questions, anybody?
Hare Krishna. So what wonderful class, Prabhuji. And after listening such a wonderful class, understanding, and we come doing same thing again and again throughout our life. So why we are wasting our time coming here, all the time, driving all the way, running, reaching in time here. And, you know, we are doing the same thing and whole life is going like this. Where to do the balancing? Where is the balancing? Nobody is able to do any balancing in spite of the hearing so wonderful lectures.
Mahaprabhu ji ki jai. So, yeah, in terms of balancing, actually all the people who are sitting in this room are already balancing. In the sense that, see, we all come to process of Krishna consciousness not by choice. Somebody held us by our ears and brought us here. So, after we have come to Krishna consciousness, it is just a regular series of choices that keep coming between us, coming before us. At every moment right now, there is a choice that people have that, chalo, lecture is over, let's go for prasad. They can get up and go. But some people, out of sheer politeness, they wait, chalo, let him finish. Right? So it's a choice. Every one of us is making a choice. Now, the more we make the percentage of choices where we choose to do the right thing, even if it is not something that I am fully convinced about, it is not something that I, you know, I am doing out of my own will, but I know it's the right thing to do, and I just do it. Whether Jai Shri Radha Gopinath Bhagavan ki jai. So whether I end up inspiring somebody by it or not. Sometimes we do things only to inspire others. You know, His Grace Muralidhar Prabhu was sharing a beautiful realization that day. He was telling me when in response to my question. Sometimes we do things only to inspire others or to impress others. Ki, you know, I'll chant nicely, then they will be inspired. Or I will speak nicely, then they'll be inspired. He said that it's a worthless exercise because then expectations come that they will follow and then they don't follow and then you become frustrated and you become angry. So the whole purpose is defeated. So you're saying that instead of having these expectations, you just do the right thing. Don't bother too much about, okay, why am I doing something? What is happening? Am I getting purified? Am I, you know, is my consciousness improving? Are they getting inspired? Is their behavior going to change or no? Don't bother. Don't try to impress. Don't try to inspire. Just do the right thing. Do the right thing at the right time. And then leave it to Krishna what he does with your activity. Hamara jo karma hai, uske saath Bhagwan kya karte hai, un swachha hai unki. He will decide what to do with our activity. So if our activity is pleasing to him and pleasing to the Vaishnavas, he will purify our heart. If it is not, he will not purify our heart. But what is in our hands? Our hands is the choice to do the right thing. So by coming to the temple, we are doing the right thing. By chanting the holy names, we are doing the right thing. By reading, hearing Srimad Bhagavatam, we are doing the right thing. And we will do wrong things also. We will continue, like you said, you know, we will continue to do wrong things also. But the more we start making choices to do the right thing, to take shelter of Bhagavatam, take shelter of holy names, more we do these things, increasingly over a period of time, we will start getting some rasa. Because we have rasa, that's why we're here. If there was no rasa, we would not be here. Some rasa, some thread is there. If we invest in that thread becomes thicker till it completely overcomes us. And then, you know, we are tied by the loving pash of the Supreme Lord. So we have to keep endeavoring till that point where the Lord ties us. Instead of yam pash, the Lord's loving pash, you know, ties us, binds us and takes us back to Godhead. Till then we have to just be patient and keep doing the right things. Hare Krishna. So there is one announcement. So this is the 75th anniversary of Back to Godhead magazine, which was started by Srila Prabhupada in 1944. So Back to Godhead, for those of you who have read Leelamrit, you will see that how much struggle Srila Prabhupada went through to actually start this magazine and keep it running with no assistant, no financial assist, no assistant or assistance of any sort. He struggled to somehow, he went hungry to, you know, write the articles, print the articles and go door to door or shop to shop and distribute. So this has this magazine is a wonderful magazine because it's, of course, its name is Back to Godhead. We may not want to go back to Godhead. We may not want to come to temple also sometimes. We may not come regularly. But the Lord comes to your home every month in form of Back to Godhead magazine to inspire you. Bhai, go back to Godhead. You know, so it's a very inspiring thing. So there is, on this occasion of 75th anniversary, the temple has organized a BTG subscription marathon. So it was from 14th April to 15th April, 15th May, sorry, 15th April to 15th May. So just 2-3 days remain in this marathon. So the BTG is available in 6 languages, English, Hindi, Marathi, Gujarati, Telugu and Oriya. And in this period of marathon, this book, this magazine is available for 250 rupees only. So there is no price, it is priceless actually. If the Lord is entering your home, there you cannot put a price to it. But there is a price because there is a cost of printing. So it's only 250 rupees per year for 12 issues. That's 20 rupees a month. That is practically free. So we will request everyone to kindly, there is a stall that is put up downstairs. There will be devotees who are waiting downstairs. So please go to that stall. If you haven't subscribed to BTG, please subscribe. BTG is the backbone of ISKCON. And what we can do is, you can subscribe yourself and encourage your friends and relatives also, and you can hand deliver to them. Those who don't come to the temple, you can give them Back to Godhead, hand deliver. So today, okay, they say today is the last day to avail the discount offer. So please contact the BTG stall downstairs for more details. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Srimad Bhagavat Mahapuran ki, Srila Prabhupada ki, Srila Gurudev ki, Nitai Gaur Premanandi, Hari Hari.